Our speakers tonight are friends. Hopefully we are all friends, at least now, as we go. Our first speaker is Father John Krivak. John and I got to know each other when I was a chaplain at Muhlenberg College, and John was assigned to be the Catholic chaplain at Muhlenberg and Cedarcrest College as well. He is a native of this area. He grew up, was basically educated in this area through his Catholic education, graduated as well from Scranton University, the good Jesuits at Scranton. He has a doctorate in education from Lehigh University and a doctorate in theology, a PhD, from Fordham University. His counterpart will be, currently, John is pastor of St. Mary's in Catasauqua. You've been there about a year now?
2 years, yes.
Okay, time goes fast when you're having fun, John.
Yeah.
Yes. Our Protestant speaker, in each one of these times, there will be a woman and a man. We're beginning with the man now, because next week we'll begin with the woman. She'll be here. The rabbi may be a little bit late next week, so we will have the first speaker on time. Our second speaker is Dr. Jill Peters, who graduated from various places, including Bible Seminary, and has a Doctor of Ministry degree. She is, at this point, head of a program that I have to go to tomorrow night. Yes, I have to do. She is one of my bosses around here. And the program is a lay education program for persons who are members of congregations to improve their skills and knowledge. And it's in spite of my being involved in it, it's a pretty good program. My wife keeps telling me that. She's taking a course there as well. And Jill does many things at Moravian, including helping students calm down. Calm down, Jill. Okay. John, over to you.
Which one would you be more comfortable?
That one.
That one, okay.
Okay, we're good. Can you hear me well? First of all, we were talking before, Jill and I, about the presentation tonight. We think we're on the right track on what Walt asked us to do. And Walt's a very difficult person to say no to. Once he asks you to do something, it usually just flows right from that. And to be honest with you, I'm a teacher. I can get up and stand in front of a whiteboard and go on for hours and hours and hours. When it comes to making a 30-minute presentation, that's a little more difficult for me to do. So I'll try to make this as interesting.
Okay, and as I say, usually if I'm in front of a whiteboard or something like that, I can go on and on and on. So this will be a bit of a challenge for me. But let's see how it goes. And I look forward to your comments and your questions as well. Let me begin by saying that our topic, sexuality, faith, and respect, gender relations today, is indeed most timely. And a question raised in an email sent to me by Walter Wagner, how can we avoid harassment and abuse, humiliation, ruined reputations, mistakes and confusion in the workplace, in school, at worship, and in social settings, is without a doubt a subject that is in the forefront of our attention today. And I know all of us know all the media attention that we've been getting or seeing about sexual abuse and harassment. According to one major law firm, the allegations of sexual abuse in the workplace in recent times have been staggering. And these problems are not limited to Harvey Weinstein and the film and television industries. Presently, sexual harassment is pervasive. It's found everywhere. Secular institutions, religious institutions. It's really a pervasive problem. For example, though the statistics vary, there is credible evidence that approximately one half of the female workforce has been sexually harassed in some way during the past 2 years. Folks, that statistic is truly staggering. And why is this continuing? And why can't companies make their workplaces safer and more comfortable for women? Moreover, how do we put a stop to the juvenile and obtuse male attitudes that view women merely as objects for sexual gratification? For example, just recently, the international fashion designer Karl Lagerfeld responded to an accusation of sexual harassment brought against a colleague by saying, and I quote, "If you don't want your pants pulled about, don't become a model. Join the nunnery. There'll always be a place for you in the convent. They're even recruiting." That's the type of attitude that is so destructive, and yet it is found in so many places and articulated by many, many people. And who can forget the words of our president in 2005 when he said while being recorded, and I quote, "When you're a star, they will let you do anything. You can even grab them by the," and here I'll substitute our president's words and simply say, "And here you can grab women by their private parts." Fortunately, in recent times, there has been announced an onslaught of women and men who are finally trying to put a stop to such behavior and comments. Organizations such as the Me Too movement are gaining traction, and they deserve our thanks. In addition, earlier this week, and I'm sure many of you are aware of this, the New York Times and the New Yorker magazine were awarded the Pulitzer Prize for Public Service. By the way, that's one of the most prestigious Pulitzer Prizes that you can receive. And they received it for their coverage of how sexual harassment and abuse towards women by powerful men goes on unheeded and unpunished in the spheres of Hollywood, politics, the media, and Silicon Valley. Tonight I want to briefly share with you from a male perspective how I believe my Christian faith can contribute to the discussion of faith, sexuality, and respect. First and foremost, when addressing this topic, I find myself asking, what can the life and the example of Jesus and his relationship with women tell me, directly or indirectly, about this matter? The answer, my good friends, is he can tell us plenty, especially when one examines the works of scholars like Marcus Borg, Donald Senior, Hans Kung, Brennan Hill, and others. Nevertheless, on the subject of Jesus and women, we have to be a bit careful because the understanding of the role of Jewish women in the first century was complex. Jews were constantly engaged in controversy over the role of women in their society and religion, and there was a wide divergence of opinion on these topics. In addition, the approach of Jesus' views on women differ widely. Some would portray Jesus as a radical feminist. They would point out how Jesus uniquely departed from the sexist customs of his day. Others disagree and argue that those who see Jesus as a radical feminist are anachronistically projecting a contemporary perspective back into the time of Jesus. With all of these complications and limitations in mind, I will attempt to offer, at least tentatively, some notions of what Jesus might have encountered with regard to the role of women in his time and indicate how we recognize the dignity of women and call them to a central position in his following. I agree with Marcus Borg in his work, Jesus, A New Vision, when he maintains that one of the most remarkable features of Jesus' ministry was his relationship with women and the dignity and equality he afforded to them, which challenged the conventional wisdom of his time. In general, the conventional culture surrounding Jesus' world was typically patriarchal, male-dominated, produced and shaped by men, taught by men, to men, from a male point of view, And although there are positive statements about women in the Hebrew Scriptures and in post-biblical Judaism, the dominant attitude reflected in the teaching of the sages, according to many scholars, was negative. Consider the following aspect of first century Judaism. Except among the poorest classes, men and women were rigidly separated in public life. Young women of the wealthier families were completely secluded until marriage. After marriage, they could not go out in public unless they were veiled. They did not talk to men outside of the families. Similarly, a respectable Jewish man, and especially a religious teacher, would not talk much with women for apparently two reasons. First, there was no benefit to be gained from women who are viewed as not very bright and preoccupied with trivia, certainly something that I hope has changed today. And also, secondly, women were considered seductive and sexually tempting. In view of this context, Jesus' itinerant group of immediate followers included women. And the sight of a sexually mixed group traveling with a Jewish holy man would have been most provocative. In addition, listen to how this story taken from the Gospels indicates how Jesus treated even sinful, vulnerable women. And I'd like to read this Gospel story to you because I know that some of you may not be familiar with the Scriptures. But to me, this is really an indication how Jesus, with the woman who's sinful, with the woman who's the outcast and rejected, still shows kindness, compassion, dignity, and respect. And this particular Gospel story is taken from Luke. One of the Pharisees asked Jesus to eat with him. So Jesus went into the Pharisee's house and sat at a table. A sinful woman in the town learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house. So she brought an alabaster jar of perfume and stood behind Jesus, his feet, and crying. She began to wash his feet with her tears, and she dried them with her hair, kissing them many times and rubbing them with perfume. When the Pharisee who asked Jesus to come to his house saw this, he thought to himself, if Jesus were a prophet, he would know that the woman touching him is a sinner. Jesus said to the Pharisee, Simon, I have something to say to you. Simon said, tell me, teacher. Jesus said, two people owed money to the same banker. One owed 500 coins and the other owed 50. They had no money to pay what they owed, but the banker told of them that they did not have to pay him. Which person will love the banker more? Simon the Pharisee answered, I think it would be the one who owed him the most money. Jesus said to Simon, you are right. Then Jesus turned to the sinful woman and said to Simon, do you see this woman? When I came into your house, you gave me no water for my feet, but she washed my feet with her tears and dried them with her hair. You gave me no kiss of greeting, she has been kissing my feet since I came in. You did not put oil on my head, but she poured perfume on my feet. I tell you that her many sins are forgiven, so she showed great love. But the woman who is forgiven and the person who is forgiven will show only a little love. Then Jesus said to her, your sins are forgiven. People sitting at the table began to say to themselves, who is this that he even forgives sins? And Jesus said to the woman, because you believed, you are saved from your sins. Go in peace. My good friends, in this passion, Jesus shows dignity, respect, and genuine concern for the sinful woman. This woman would also have been very vulnerable because of her social status. But Jesus shows no sign of taking advantage of her or manipulating her in any way. A few other aspects from the gospel regarding Jesus with women. In the gospel story of Martha and Mary, Jesus endorses Mary's actions as she relates to Jesus as a disciple relates to a teacher. In first century Jewish context, this is a radical point. Jesus treated women and men as equally capable and worthy of dealing with sacred matters. In a time when a respectable sage was not even to converse with a woman outside his family, and when women were viewed as both dangerous and inferior, the practice of Jesus discussing religious matters with a woman would be startling for his day. Interestingly, Jesus left no teaching at all concerning women as a class of people, but this can be viewed as a positive, since he treated every woman he met as a person in their own right. Overall, women are presented in a very favorable light throughout the Gospels. In the Roman Catholic tradition, Mary, the mother of Jesus, is held up as the model of Christian faith. While the male colleagues are hiding in fear, women courageously follow Jesus on his way to crucifixion. And he is seen first by women after his resurrection. He commissioned the women to go and tell his disciples that he has risen. Hence, women are given the responsibility of first delivering the essential message of Christianity. Jesus entrusts truths to women as well as to men. Everything about Christ's attitude to women confirms and clarifies the truth about the equality of man and woman. This is an essential equality between man and woman, since both of them, the woman as much as the man, are created in the image and likeness of God and can receive the outpouring of divine truth and the love and the Holy Spirit. Finally, in the miracle accounts, Jesus reaches out to men and women without partiality with his healing and enabling power. A careful reading of the scriptures reveals that Jesus is someone who accepted both men and women as beloved creatures of God, ready, eager, and capable of building his kingdom here on earth. In summary, when I look at the Gospels and I look at the example that I must follow, Jesus treats all women with respect, with dignity, equality, and reverence, regardless of their social position. He never manipulates women, exploits women, pejoratively prejudges women, or uses women as a means to an end. He never takes advantage of a woman who is vulnerable. So too, it must be for all men who claim to be a follower of our Lord Jesus Christ. So that's the first part I want to establish in this presentation, the attitude that Jesus took towards women during his day, especially in light of some of the attitudes of those who would abuse or harass women that I started with at the beginning of this presentation. Let me continue now. Nevertheless, in matters of faith, sexuality, and respect, we must do more than simply talk about the values of Jesus. We must act on these values. This is a lesson given to us by the methodology found in liberation theology. It teaches us that we have to critically examine those factors in our culture, our laws, economics, mass media, educational systems that may cause, promote, or enable sexual harassment, and work to change and eliminate the sinful structures around us that may promote or enable sexual harassment. A good example of what it means to study the conditions that may promote or enable sexual harassment in the workplace can be found in this excerpt from a book entitled Sexual Harassment on the Job, What It Is and How to Stop It by Petroselli and Reba. And I begin this passage. If sex discrimination forces women into lower paying jobs, sexual harassment helps keep them there. This may not be the intention of the harasser in every instance, but it is often the effect. Seen in this context, male workers who harass a woman on the job are doing more than annoying her. They're reminding her of her vulnerability, creating tensions that make her job more difficult, making her hesitant to seek higher paying jobs where she may perceive the tension as even greater. In short, sexual harassment creates a climate of intimidation and repression. A woman who is a target of sexual harassment often goes through the same process of victimization as one who has suffered rape, battering, or other gender-related crimes, frequently blaming herself and doubting her own self-worth. Women employed in the fields that are traditionally considered women's work, such as waitressing and secretaries, are often given menial, degrading tasks. They are often called demeaning names, and they are led to believe that a certain amount of male domination and sexism is normal. All of this reinforces the idea that women workers are of little value in the workplace. Women who try to break in traditional all-male work, such as construction jobs or investment banking, often suffer even more intense harassment, clearly aimed at forcing them to leave. Thus, sexual harassment often accomplishes informally what laws against sex bias discrimination theoretically prohibit: gender-based requirements for a job. A woman subjected to sexual harassment endures pressure, degradation, or hostility that her male coworker does not have to endure, making it just that much harder to compete for job and for advancement. And there, my good friends, I think you see the difference in two poles that we really have to consider when we look at sexual harassment, abuse, hostility between the sexes, especially males towards females. We have to look at the heart. We have to look at the thinking of men, but also we have to look at the structures, the economics, the politics that surround us that can promote this evil, foster it, and enable it. So in listening to this passage, I hope you can see why it is necessary to turn our gaze not only inwardly toward the human heart, but also outwardly toward social and economic structures, if we are to effectively address the problem of faith, sexuality, and respect. Further, liberation theology would also demand an up-to-date, effective policy against sexual harassment, and this should be in place in all companies, schools, workplaces, and churches. That policy needs to be clear and understandable. It needs to be available to all employees in a convenient manner, and it needs to educate people on what constitutes sexual harassment. For there are simply too many old men whose ideas of what is acceptable in the workplace is simply outdated and objectionable. Locker room talk is simply not acceptable anywhere. Finally, the policy needs to be strictly and swiftly enforced, and if a claim is substantiated, appropriate discipline must be enforced. And here I just might add something about my own particular church on this matter. For years, for decades, in the Roman Catholic Church, we never treated the abuse of children with, I think, the seriousness that such a sin demands, and we always had a very rather loose, haphazard policy towards abuse. The result in our church of that carelessness has been an utter disaster. Close to $4 billion in payments may go out from our church to victims of abuse. And by the way, abuse not only takes place in the Roman Catholic Church, but I'm sure in many other churches as well. And other churches are watching the Catholic Church very closely to see what we're doing in this matter, to see what we can teach them on this matter. By the way, when it comes to this matter, I never had any idea that I would be fingerprinted as a priest, background check as a priest. I have to go with a letter of certification if I leave my diocese saying that I'm fit for service and ministry. And anyone who works with minors in our church really has to go through the ringer. In Jill, I think you were saying the same thing to me as well on that. So carelessness in this area has really been, it's been a disaster for us. In addition to that, I think our church has to catch up a bit on the teachings of Jesus and respect for women and full inclusion of women in the decision-making body of the church. Jesus spoke of women carrying the essential message of Christianity. Jesus mentions women as being central in the church. Jesus lists women as having a master-disciple relationship. Yet my particular church, there was no ordination of who? Women. Yeah. No ordination on the diaconate level, priesthood level, bishop level. By the way, one little surprise that I always tell people in Catholic churches, a woman, technically in a Catholic church, can't be a lector. She can read, but she can't hold the office of lector in the church. She can serve Mass, but she can't hold the office of acolyte in the church. Consequently, when I read initially that we were now going to have female altar servers, there was this great buzz in the media that finally things are beginning to break down in Catholicism. That's not the case at all. And I think we really have to examine what women are doing in the church and how we can better include them in the church, especially in light of the teachings of Jesus. In addition to that, there's still celibacy for the clergy in the Roman Catholic Church. And interestingly enough, marriage in the Roman Catholic Church is lifted or elevated to the degree of a sacrament. In other words, it's a special way in which we receive special grace to carry out our vocation in life. And yet, married priesthood, it's not quite here yet in the church. And that's something I think we also have to look at. And I guess also another thing that I would look at in my church would be this. Not too long ago, we elected a new pope. But it really struck me when I saw the people going in to do the election of the pope. Basically, older men of past generations going in to elect this leader. Very monolithic. And sometimes I think there's such great potential, for leadership, for a change of view among women that in the Catholic Church we simply aren't taking advantage of. And the last thing I think I would say is this. The ethics of Jesus, I believe, are very positive and very favorable towards women. They're diametrically opposed to any type of abuse towards a woman. There's no doubt about that whatsoever. But I also want to say that there have been times in my church history where we always haven't followed the teachings of Jesus on women and sexuality all that clearly. And especially with the patristics, for those of you who are seminary students, you know, the patristics, the early church fathers, really many of them basically viewed sex as something sinful. And matter is something dirty. And thank goodness we've moved beyond that. So I guess in summary, what I would say to you is this. When I think of respect, when I think of avoiding sexual abuse, I really turn to the model of my Christian faith, Jesus. And I ask myself, how would he conduct this particular situation that we have today? And I think his values and I think his goodness towards women can greatly help us understand and can greatly help us in formulating an ethic the way males should relate to women. So consequently, I'll end on this paragraph. I've tried to demonstrate how the values of Jesus combined with the methodology of liberation theology can challenge our minds, our hearts, and our social structures, and contribute to a discussion of faith, sexuality, and respect. But there is still much more work that needs to be done. But given the growing sentiment that sexual harassment and abuse will not be tolerated anywhere, under any circumstances, I believe we are moving in the right direction on this important and this timely matter. Thank you very much.
Those of you from congregations, I have brochures along for my program. I always have to plug this. So if you're in a Protestant Catholic congregation and want to know a little bit more about Crossroads and what we do in terms of helping congregations with leadership, with outreach, things like that, come and see me and I'll tell you about what we do. Thank you very much for your presentation. This is a broad and complex topic, and each of us are going to hit on a couple little things. When Dr. Wagner asked me to present, I said to him, I'm not a theologian. And my field in the church, that's a better idea. My field in the church, I deal with church culture all the time. So this is far out of what I normally do. But, you know, if I'm approaching this subject in terms of culture, it becomes something that I can understand more. And I was grateful when Walter said to me, be yourself. You don't have to worry about being the representative of a whole theological position, because I couldn't do that. But as a Christian Protestant woman, many things came to mind for me. And they are my experiences, and they are varied over several denominations where I have belonged, and over many decades. And I think these thoughts, when I put them all together, reflected how my faith and the evolution of my particular personal experience has been informed by my faith. And I think that maybe my journey is not that unusual, that other women would connect with it. C.S. Lewis, a theologian who wrote The Chronicles of Narnia and some other famous books, he was very well respected, and he had a theory, I've been told, about men and women working together, that eventually, when men and women are working together, what a nice guy, thank you, that eventually when men and women work together, there's going to be an attraction. And we can't avoid that. And I think that's a little fatalistic. And I don't know that that's absolutely true, but also, what we do with that attraction, what we do with those feelings is more important. How we act or don't act on them is critical. I grew up in the 50s. I was jealous of the guys around me. I saw that doors were open to them that weren't open to me. Boys and girls were often kept apart doing things. There were certain things that the guys could do that the girls weren't allowed to. The expectations on my younger brother were much higher than what were on me. He's my only sibling. He's 16 months younger, and he was treated as a firstborn, and I took full advantage of that. The pressure was on him to exceed in math, in school, and everything else, and I could lay back and go, okay, fine. You be the studious one. Middle school and high school. Through the 60s, up to the beginning of the 70s, I found that gap also growing wider for gender opportunities. And I think when we look at gender opportunities, it informs this whole thing of how we relate to each other. There were more sports funded for guys. More expectations on them to succeed. More pressure to look at college. Many, many more opportunities. And I think some of you women in the room would agree with me, having lived through that also. One of the opportunities afforded to the high school guys at my church was going to career night at Western Electric. Some of us remember the Western Electric plant over in East Allentown. Western Electric was eventually became part of the AT&T system. Western Electric was the place where they mass produced the first transistors. So it's a pretty famous location. One of our youth advisors was an engineer there, and he recruited the guys to go on a tour. And I didn't think this was fair. How did they get to go? And I didn't. And I wanted very much to do this. So three of the guys from my church were selected to go. One's now a minister. One, my brother, has an MBA and does finance at Lehigh Valley Hospital, and the other one is industrial sales. I was the one who ended up in microelectronics. I have called on probably a dozen Western Electric and Bell Labs plants over several states. It would have been great for me to experience that. But we were kept separate. And the church reinforced that also. So it was church, it was school, but it was the culture where I felt this forced separation and differences in opinion, in experiences. At church, I was raised in a pretty conservative Protestant denomination, a lot different than where I worship now in mainline congregations. The guys were expected to be leaders, and to this day they only ordain men, even though most of them had no interest in being in leadership positions. They were the only ones that were allowed to do that. For some reason, I became the youth group president. And some people were upset with that, which is interesting. We were taught that as young women, it was our responsibility to keep relationships chaste. Because as we were taught at church, the guys really had no control over their sexual urges. It was our responsibility to dress and act appropriately, to not let things get out of hand, because the guys had no ability to stop. There was a physical point of no return for them. We had tremendous pressure on us as young women in that faith community. And then there were the rules. There were hem gauges to make sure that our hems were above our knees. No makeup, no movies, because, you know, most teenage pregnancies happen after seeing a movie. At least that's what we were taught. No dancing, because dancing simply a vertical version of what today we call the horizontal cha-cha. You can figure out what that is. I was jealous of my Presbyterian and Lutheran friends because they had dances in their church basements. We had shuffleboard with two of the girls over here and two of the guys way over at the other end of the shuffleboard court, and never meeting in between. But being separate like that, we never really learned to live together. We never really learned that respect. We had other rules too. If you were sitting on a couch with a young man, 3 out of 4 of your feet had to be flat on the floor. That was an important rule that we were taught at church. There were some of our group who quickly discovered the extent of activities that can take place while still having 3 flat feet on the floor. It was like sofa twister. And yes, there were pregnancies that came out of our youth group. And why? Well, as teenagers, the growing sexuality and respect for the opposite gender was never addressed. Instead, we were given a lot of rules, the thou shalt nots. Our normal development was repressed. Someone once told me that repression is like trying to hold a large beach ball underwater, standing in a pool holding this beach ball. And it takes a lot of energy and concentration and awareness, and you have to focus completely on that task. If you even for a minute look away or scratch your ear, there's a chance that that beach ball will fly out of the water. And when it does, it's going to fly out at an inappropriate angle and become airbound. And a conservative church that does not balance rules with respect, and again, I'm talking about my experience, this is exactly what happens. As kids, we learned a lot of scripture, and I'm so thankful for that. I'm so thankful for that. We were taught, particularly Romans 12, 1 and 2, King James Version. Of course, we learned the King James. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, who is your reasonable service, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed. Be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is good and acceptable and the perfect will of God. We had to memorize that. And we were taught that meant that we should not have sex and we should not sin in a physical way. And again, the pressure was on the women. But we never read further than that. And if you go down another verse or two, it says, for we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office. So, we being many are one body in Christ, and everyone members one another. I never heard that part in high school. That's a completely different message. We are members of each other. That teaches respect. We all have our gifts and our role. There's balance. There is mutuality. There is care and concern for each other. We need each other to be complete in the body of Christ. When I went to college, I connected with a group of Christians on campus right away, and because I knew the people back at my home church would ask me about that. And I met people in many different denominations, including Catholics. First time I really got to know Catholics. And I was shocked that they believed in God pretty much the same way I did. That was a surprise to me. I remember my pastor on Sunday morning praying for those Catholics across the street because they didn't believe that the way we did. I saw the movie last week, The Battle of the Sexes, with about Billie Jean King and Bobby Riggs. If you grew up in the 70s like I did, watch that movie, because it's a real flashback to how men and women related to each other. The newscasters interviewing one of the male tennis stars and is standing and talking with him like colleagues. And then he's interviewing the woman, and he puts his arm around her and holds her close, like almost like he's hugging her. The way women were treated in the 70s, and I watched the movie and went, oh my gosh, I lived through that. I remember those kind of things. It's so different. There was another experience that I had in college with regard to the interactions of genders with some real cultural realities. I went to Kutztown. Kutztown's surrounded by farms that are owned by the Old Order Mennonites. Mennonites are a very conservative group of Christians, and they are in many regards even more conservative than the Amish that you find in Lancaster County. But they look very similar. They wear the same kind of clothing, things like that. To be a bishop, you can't have any electricity on your house or in your farm, which means if you got elected bishop, you had to give up the generator that was in your barn that kept the chickens warm and things like that. There was a real economic impact on you becoming voted into the bishop office. So we had an opportunity as college students to take a course on Old Order Mennonites and to learn about what they believed and how they lived. And we visited a home, we visited shops, and on one Sunday morning we were allowed to attend a church service, and it was fascinating. So here we were, a group of college students, going to a Mennonite church. Now we drove in, but they all came in their horse and buggies, because they're not allowed to have cars. It was a long service. The men sat up front, and then in the very front were the elders, and there were pegs on the wall where they each hung their black hats. And then in the back were all the women and children, and we were in the back of them. 2 hours long in German, or their version of German. And everything was going okay until the college guys in our group noticed that the Old Order Mennonite women were openly breastfeeding, and they were shocked. Because we don't, at that age, we didn't see breasts out in public. But that was part of their culture. That was completely understandable. We never got invited back, and that was the last time the college was allowed to run that course. But those of us that had that experience learned a lot. And we saw a different cultural group, Protestants, still Protestants, a different cultural group in how they handled sexuality and how they handled various things. Also in college, I got to know people who had no faith at all. That was new to me too. I had always been around people who believed just like my family did. I had been taught that apart from God, you cannot be a moral person. Then I met people who did not believe in God, and some of them were much more moral than I was. And I had to think about that. And they treated other people with much more respect than I did. And they were open and welcoming, and they were encouraging of others and patient, much more patient than I was. This didn't make sense to me. I had to figure this out. It was confusing because I had learned the rules and yet didn't have the respect. And they had great respect for others. They believed it and they lived it. There was morality separate from faith. That was hard for me to understand. And soon I would learn, with the fall of many televangelists, that even with people of God, there might not be morality. And often it came out in sexual ways, like a beach ball. So during the 70s, all other areas of our lives were changing. The ground was moving, especially for those of us who came out of conservative backgrounds. And we were trying to understand how to relate to the opposite sex, how to relate to each other. We saw Elvis on TV. That was a shock. The Beatles came to town with their hair down to their collars, and that was inappropriate. And there was Woodstock. And then there was Roe v. Wade. And that was an interesting and difficult to figure out thing. Roe v. Wade is the decriminalization of abortions and the Supreme Court upholding the woman's right to make decisions regarding her own body. Where did that leave us as young women with conservative upbringings? How as people of faith, could we rationalize our way through that? Because on one hand, giving the person the ability to make up their mind about their bodies, to make their own decisions. But on the other hand, it was abortion. It was a tragedy. Thankfully, I've never had to make that choice. But I was thankful on one hand that people could. But then on the other hand, I'm an adopted mother of three siblings. And I'm keenly aware that their birth mother had multiple abortions. And we have missed knowing and loving the siblings of my kids. And my kids are aware that there's a hole in their family where there are kids missing. They came and told me that. So here's this balance. Two very, very different things. So I think there are some confusing things we look at. There are some times when we've got to sit back and really step through things and talk about how we respect each other. So how does my faith inform me on these issues? Certainly, my church had a rule for everything. okay, and we all learned the rules, because that's easy. And they weren't all bad rules. And some were helpful, and I am grateful for being raised like that. But what does Scripture tell me? Well, Scripture has rules too, right? Ten Commandments. So I look at the women in the Bible. I look at the stories of the Bible, and I think there are some notable exceptions. I think there are some really good stories. I look at somebody like Abigail. Abigail is someone who learned that David's army was upset with her husband. Abigail's husband was a jerk. Okay, and because he disrespected David, the warrior. He had the chance came up where his whole family was going to be wiped out. And Abigail found out about that. And she took what she had. She used the resources at her hand. And she cooked and made food. And she went out and met David and provided the food for the army that her husband refused to do. This turned out so good for Abigail. She ended up marrying David eventually. Here's a story of someone who creatively figured out how to work through that issue. And there are other passages. And I look at the women, the Mary and Martha, the Mary Magdalene. You mentioned these women that Jesus talked with. And the way Jesus spoke with them, we have glimpses of respect. We have glimpses of how we can deal with the opposite sex. We have glimpses that maybe C.S. Lewis is wrong, that we can deal with each other, and it doesn't have to turn into an attraction. So we're coming up to, I believe we're coming up to Pentecost. Is that correct? Story about in Acts chapter 2 of Pentecost, Peter is standing up, and he quotes the prophet Joel. And he says, in the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all my people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. So he's talking about sons and daughters, equally. Young and old, equally. Slaves and free, equally. The Spirit equally comes to all of us. There is hope and there's encouragement in that. This is different than what I was taught. I was taught that the men had a position higher than me and that they were going to be telling me what to do. And that was so frustrating to me. What about the Me Too? You mentioned Me Too. The hashtag Me Too that started a couple months ago. And quickly, almost every woman I know posted on Facebook, hashtag Me Too, saying, I have been a victim of some kind of a sexual assault or some kind of an inappropriate sexual incident. And I know one woman who said, I didn't think about it, but I sat down and I started listing things, and I'm up to 12. I'm up to 12 incidences in my life when someone has touched me inappropriately or exposed themselves to me or said things incredibly inappropriate. My husband said to me, what's the big deal with this Me Too? You know, really. And I said, it is the experience of almost every woman. Many of us can list times that bad things have happened to us because there has been no respect from people from the opposite gender. So I said to him, let me ask you some questions. When you get in the car, do you check the back seat? He said, no. I said, when you carry your keys, do you carry them so the one with the longest key sticks out if it's at night and you're going to cart? He goes, no, why would I do that? I said, have you ever walked down the middle of the street at night? Well, no, I walk on the sidewalk. I said, have you gotten out of an elevator because someone else entered it? And even though you wanted to continue riding, you got out and waited for the next elevator? And the first thing when you do, when you get in your car, do you lock your car doors? He said no to every one of those things. And then he looked at me and he said, I get it. It is different for you. You do have to lead your lives differently. You do have to be careful because there are predators out there. And hopefully they're not in the church. Hopefully the church can make a difference with those kind of things. Child abuse issues. I was a consultant for a couple of years in many congregations with the child abuse issues, and the church, and I'm not talking about the Catholic Church, I'm talking about Protestant churches, we have made many mistakes with that. We have said, don't worry about it. Children won't remember it. You don't need to get them counseling. That's not true. Don't worry about this sexual harassment situation. The woman will get over it. That's not true either. The church needs to be on the forefront of teaching respect and of healing people. This is the place. This is the place for people to come who have had brokenness in their lives and to have an opportunity to talk about it and become whole again.